in the golden age of rock and roll, where they were throwing around ludicrous amounts of money, they finally figured out that it should look like something as well as sound like something. Nigel, of course, worked with Ice House and also with Men at Work. The next speaker is, I think the best way to describe this person is, Andrew Hansen is part of Nigel's family of choice. Please.
Sorry. I've had to cut all the adjectives. I approached Nigel Triffitt, the new director of student theatre at Monash University in 1972, seeking plays for the Gay Liberation Front. From that day, my life changed. I met Rabelais, Ruby, Alf Hercules, and I learned about dreams, deaths and entrances. I ran away from academia to join his circus as Queenie in Fortune and Men's Eyes, and later in Yellow Brick Road shows. We were banned in most states of Australia, but lauded in university lunchtime theatres. I became a cosmic ninja dressed in black for Nigel in the puppet theatre. He insisted I develop my career specialty, the nude scene, which cannot be justified from the theatrical text. With Yellow Brick Road shows, I travelled the world. We went to Darwin, the first theatre company in there after Cyclone Tracy. We travelled to Southern Europe and Morocco to the tune of the Marrakesh Express, and later to North America, Europe and Southeast Asia. We were mere pawns on his stage, but we'd do anything for him, and we were paid in international travel. Now, my life partner, Jeffrey Lipp, was a dynamic psychiatrist, one who uses talk therapies as opposed to handing out medications. Jeffrey dealt with families. Families of origin, that is, those that you're born into, and families of choice. Nigel saw me in a different light after Dr. Lipp became my partner in 1977. But I was still Nigel's inept gorilla in the rehearsal room, creating Nigel's secrets for Handspan Theatre. Jeffrey and I were in the city one afternoon and dropped in to see Nigel in his Lonsdale Heights apartment. He told us his mother, Joan, had just revealed to him that she was not his real mother. He was, in fact, adopted. Nigel confided in us. He obviously needed some support in evaluating this life-altering information. Jeffrey didn't consult. He just listened to Nigel as Nigel discussed this secret that he'd been guarded from by the Triffitts. We went on to share many of Nigel's secrets, and Jeffrey and I were often there for momentous events. When Nigel was hospitalised while rehearsing Rocky Horror in New Zealand, a message was sent to us. Jeffrey called the hospital, and being a doctor, he talked until he reached Nigel. Nigel told us that he was coming home to Melbourne. This was not pneumonia. This was AIDS. I had a key to his Bourke Street flat and prepared the apartment. As health episodes arose, Jeffrey found him a great doctor and then a great dentist. Later, when Joan Triffitt was dying, Nigel's gay pals pulled together money and I went to Hobart to support Nigel while he maintained a daily vigil by Joan's bed. That's what families do. The people of the theatre became Nigel's family, his family of choice. I look around the room and I see Nigel's pals. We're his relatives of choice, his brothers, sisters, etc. He was never very good at intimacy, but you knew when Nigel liked you. He hated Christmas. He loved birthdays as long as it was yours, not his. Babies, weddings, struggling with adoptees seeking their birth parents, and all kinds of family triumphs and tragedies. If there was a death or an illness, Nigel would put you on his worry list. He'd call on a daily basis, listening and giving advice until he felt you were in the clear. Even today, Nigel would be ringing to make sure that we're all right. But like most families, there are rough times. All happy families are happy in the same way, but dysfunctional families are dysfunctional in their own unique way. Families fight because you know that you love each other. The family tie can't be unravelled. Nigel's family of choice is no different. Nigel ruthlessly excised friends. He stopped ringing and he stopped answering the phone. So many people feel discarded, cut off with no explanation and no warning. He became elusive. You rarely knew if he was in Melbourne or overseas, and he'd get back quietly sliding behind his desk into the king chair, up all night, writing, having another joint, blogging his last trip and writing his great stumble forward stories about the people of sea cruises, Africa, Asia and India, and then immersing himself in the Triffitt histories. Look, I'm not here to apologise for Nigel, but I want to share an insight. As age and bad health started to take their toll, Nigel became even more self-absorbed. People were staring at his emaciated physique. A small facial blemish was removed, giving him a new lease of life, but then he had trouble walking distances. What I thought was leg surgery may have been heart surgery. He didn't want us to see the physical changes. In the fall of Singapore, a survivor from Changi prison camp repeats, "Anyone can be a hero. It's all right to be frightened. I've been frightened. Just don't let any other bugger see you." In hindsight, I hear Nigel speaking. I knew his friends were hurting. Nigel had cut them off. I didn't see Nigel for about 6 months before he died, but he and I maintained a weekly 90-minute phone call. He'd repeatedly ask, "How is Peter Wilson? What is John Rogers up to? You're going to visit Jackie and Sam. What about Winston? John Truscott? Bradley Wright, Peter Charlton and Adam Smith, dead but not forgotten, discussed in phone gossip." I told news and he would bitch, but he'd always inquire. I don't think he stopped loving us. I think he was just protecting us from seeing him and the ravages of time. When someone dies, I hope that the pain and stress are alleviated, that the anguish of life lifts, youth is restored and ailments are cured. People don't die of age and disease, they die of life. Now, one small story about Nigel Triffitt, now cosmic consultant. Not the magic of the theatre, but a believe it or not. Sarah Triffitt and I, families, were the only people to attend Nigel's funeral. Incense, a flower, some Tibetan instructions. Afterwards, we stood on the lawn in Springvale in the weak Melbourne sun. Nigel came around the corner in a lady-driven hearse on the way to be cremated. The hearse got stuck entering the peak hour traffic on the Springvale Road. Sarah and I had time to bid our farewell several times over. And then Nigel's wake... We could say goodbye to him several times. Nigel's wake consisted of cigarettes and chocolate in the front seat of my car. Sarah and I then drove along Springvale Road to the Eastern Freeway. Shaken as we drove through the peak hour traffic, we were overtaken by a beige workers' truck bearing the Victorian number plate, I kid you not, NIGEL0. Of all the thousands of number plates in Victoria, how did this one appear at this time? At roughly the moment when Nigel was being put in the fire. We could only gasp, laugh, and thank him for the omen. Nigel worked very hard to keep us, his family of choice, separated. It has unravelled today. We're all here, and there's a lot of us who are absent. Nigel, we are talking about you, and there's nothing you can do except sit on your cloud, dangling your skinny legs down, smoking another jointy thing and laughing. The only way it could be improved is with fireworks.
Stupid thing. I've just remembered something. As Andrew said, Nigel lived at Lonsdale Heights, just up the road from the Comedy Theatre. And it says something about Nigel. This is how his calendar ran. I remember he said, I came out of Lonsdale Heights and I saw a whole bunch of dwarfs and I thought it must be Christmas. He told me that story. Nigel spent the last 20 years luxuriating in travel. And I suspect much of that was underwritten by the Tap Dogs. I have here a message from Dean Perry from Tap Dogs. Lisa and I are deeply saddened by the passing of Nigel. In 1994, my agent introduced me to Nigel. At the time, all I knew of him was that he had an impressive track record as a designer, deviser, and director of his own shows. Nigel delivered a model of the set of Tap Dogs to my apartment, and I was both excited and nervous of what I could create, and could I live up to the expectations of his design? Years later, Nigel would still laugh about when he first showed me the model and how I went pale and disappeared into the toilet. Something I do remember well. We collaborated very hard in those early days and he taught me many things about staging. Thank you, Nigel, for your guidance and confidence that you instilled in me that will last forever. I will never forget on opening night, looking into the audience mid-show, petrified, and I caught eyes with Nigel, and he mouthed the words, "You're cooking with gas," one of his favourite sayings. Well, we still are, mate, and that set is on the back of a truck today, and it's halfway up the East Coast, almost 2 decades on. Dean Perry. As I say, Nigel seemed to underwrite his next 20 years of travel from that endeavour. Greg Snowden is a man who travelled with him.
Perhaps it may be more accurate if could be said that Nigel Triffitt travelled with me at some point and enlivened the whole experience. In 2000, Nigel accompanied myself and 35 men on a journey through the central desert. It was a shamanic journey, a journey of spirit. And I think for many of Nigel's friends, there was a big question mark about why on earth would he want to do this. Nigel had first come out onto the Pitjantjatjara lands with me in 1989, when I was taking groups of people out to a small outstation called Angaja. And Angaja had been host, and the people from Angaja, Charlie Ilyajari particularly, and his wife Nganinja, to Handspan Theatre a few years before that, when they came out and workshopped a production called The Haunted. And in a strange way, I'm reflecting today, talking to a number of people here, that The Haunted actually was an inspiration for a further 20 years of people going out into that desert country to learn from the traditional people of the land. And I remember very clearly on that first trip that Nigel enjoyed not so much travelling to all the sacred sites and to the dreaming places and to hear the songs and the dances, but sitting back at camp and having the snotty-nosed, wild-haired, scrubby, wild children running all over him, and the old ladies sitting there making tea and damper, laughing and singing their songs, and the old men sitting by the fire with the smoke rising and their old clothes muttering stories of kangaroo hunts and old times. And he said, Greg, this is the key of this culture. This is the key of people living in the land and living together and close. And it was that became a further inspiration for developing these trips, which became quite famous, of people going out to try and touch the essence of this country and the spirit of the land, and to work with the ngangaris, the healers, the magicians, the visionaries of that culture. And in 2000, I think it was a pivotal time for Nigel. It was shortly after he had been so intimately involved in the opening ceremony of the Olympic Games. And I think at that point it was, well, where do you go to now? And I had contacted him to invite him to come on one of these trips, and he accepted. And I invited him not as a participant, but as a co-leader, as someone who could bring something of the world of his magic and his vision to meet with the magicians and the visionaries of the desert. It was an extraordinary trip of 35 people, and again, it in its own way mirrored the production of The Haunted. The first morning, an hour before we're about to start, I get a phone call to say that the bus had blown up, and we had to somehow get 35 blokes into vehicles that would travel 2,000 kilometres through the desert. So we all ended up in the backs of troop carriers and travelling on this extraordinary journey. There were a number of Nigel moments in that journey that still stand out. When we first arrived at one of these small outstations called Waldijada, which is very close to the border of Northern Territory, South Australia and Western Australia, and we sit down and we're greeted by some of the old women there, and they're in their ragged old clothes and they're sitting by the fire, the smoke curling up. And I brought Nigel over and introduced him and said, this is Nigel, he's comes from Melbourne, but he helped create that extraordinary part of the opening ceremony at the Olympic Games, just held in Sydney. And the women went, yeah, us too, we were there. And Nigel looks and said, what? He said, yeah, we were at the start of it. We did all that dance. It was our dance that opened it. And it was this amazing moment where he was suddenly the meeting of these producers of this most extraordinary show seen by millions of people in the world were sitting here in this most remote part of the country. And he immediately was engaged in conversation about how fantastic it was and how much he enjoyed their show, and they said how much they enjoyed his, and it was great. But he also was able to take a back seat in the whole production, because the shamanic journey is a spiritual theatre. It's a theatre in the wild. And it was actually very much modelled upon the production of The Haunted that I saw in Fitzroy by chance in about 1986, I think. Short-lived though it was an extraordinary evocation of the potential of our culture meeting with desert culture in the realm of spirit. And Nigel helped us navigate that in many ways, but also because of his involvement with Handspan at that time, that enabled thousands of white fellas to be able to enter the dreaming. On the trip, we had a moment one night at this Waldi Jutta where the fires were burning and the winds were howling and the spirit was whistling around, and there was a lot of men's stuff in the circle. There was challenges and confrontations and backdowns and crying and yelling. And at one moment, Nigel, sitting quietly in his chair, said, "Excuse me, gentlemen." And everything stopped for a moment. He said, "Well, from where I'm sitting," he said, "I can see that there seems to be four main groups of people here. There's the wimps, the wannabes, the wankers, and the warriors. And there aren't too many fucking warriors," he said. And it summed everything up in that moment. And within seconds, it was like a whirlwind swept through the camp. And I think within about 2 minutes, about 15 guys were lying on the ground going through this extraordinary cathartic experience, all set off by Nigel's production capacities. But he also became a spiritual advisor. And as been pointed out by others, he gave incredibly generously of his time sitting with the men on the trip and helping them understand what was going on, giving them his detailed perception from the many places that he spied on the trip. And I think people who know Nigel know that he would never sit still in one spot to look at anything. He was always getting a different perspective, and he would often come and talk to us who were guiding this trip about what he'd seen from behind the clump of spinifex, or from the top of the hill, or over standing behind the old outhouse. And that the world has many different facets. He became our big brother, and it was another family that he had was, and as you saw some of the photos, the large family of men. He became the kuta, the big brother who would talk to us and share his experience. And I think the nature of a shamanic journey is it's a vision quest, and it's a quest that people go on to when they sense their life is about to change, to get a picture of where to go. And in that journey where we were actually taken into the dance of the rainbow serpent, the wanambi, and he saw that this sacred theatre is something that can exist in the wild, in country, it can exist in life, and that through that sacred theatre, we invoke the spirit of the dreaming. We invoke, and led by the old people out there, and called in this rainbow serpent who followed us through storms and winds and rainbows and creek beds that would dry one moment and flowing the next and then dry the next. That in the world there were places that he could travel as a traveller, but also as someone with a mission and someone who could use the experience of his theatrical world to help create theatre at large. And I think that's where he went for that period after that trip. At the end of that trip, in his own inimitable fashion, he won the award. He got the award as the number one ngankari, the number one shaman, the number one healer, visionary, magician. And I think that we're all here to acknowledge that that's really the award that he carries through his life.
the story, go read a book, don't come and see one of my plays, because people will come away disappointed if they expect an adventure story or something like that. It's not concerned with those issues, it's attempting to break those rules. Simple as that.
Tap dancers from the cast of Tap Dogs, Hot Shoe Shuffle and Steel City. 500 tap dancers from tap schools all over Australia. 500 jazz dancers, ab sailors, airboard riders. More than 2,500 performers in that sequence, designed and directed by Nigel Triffitt.